Today, we're talking about the transformation of a man's life. Which men? You, as a man. Have you ever noticed that on Mother's Day in church, and even in the culture, it's like, mothers are awesome, mothers are amazing, mothers are the best, my mother's better than your mother. You know, your mom can't beat my mom. If we had a mom-off competition, you would all fail to my mom is the best. You know, that's it. You know, it's a mom-off. I don't know. I just made that up, I guess. A mom-off competition. But it's always that way. Nobody ever talks about this. Nobody ever says on Mother's Day, let me tell you how to be a better woman. Because we are all afraid to say that, right? It's, not only is it wrong, we'd be afraid to say it. But what is it? What are the messages around Father's Day? The message around Father's Day is, well, you know, men in this country, it's a sad state of affairs. God has a message for you, men. Here's your 5-point plan to be a decent father. You know, around Father's Day, it's kind of weird around Father's Day. And I had to get a lot of Father's Day under my belt as a church leader to be able to think, this is wrong. My commitment to you as a pastor, I will never preach a sermon on Father's Day about how men ought to be better. That's not what we need to hear those days. Back in the summertime, Casey had a message on the prophetess Deborah and how she drove a tent peg through the skull of a man who's the enemy of God. And about how she was a victorious woman who led God's people. Awesome. Today, I want to kind of give the man's version of that. The message is called Man Up. When you hear the term man up, you think like, okay, like be the man, like stand up for yourself, stand up and protect somebody, or sacrifice. Don't just please yourself. You know, be strong. Real men don't cry. You know, all that kind of stuff. But what I want you to see this, in this terminology, man up. Man, God has a plan for men to be high in this world. To realize and recognize their high position before God. I'm so grateful for the equality with women that's happened over the last 50 years in our country and like many places in the world, many of you soldiers have been to. That's not the case. I'm so grateful for that. But men, have you ever noticed this? It is almost like in some places, maybe at work or even in the home or even at church, it's like, how did we raise up women to give them equal, like, status before God and to really say we recognize what God's scriptures already says about women. But somehow that's kind of, in some settings, demeaned manhood. If you haven't noticed that, it's there. And almost like this, we don't need you, men. The world doesn't need you. Families can function without you. The government can function without a man standing up and being the man. Churches don't need you. And this message is out there in our world. You're not needed. It's man down. It's man down. And today I want to say, like the military is saying, I don't want to leave a fallen comrade. I want to be able to say, God has a high position for men. It's not better than women's position. But it's one that we have to take.
Amen.
And if we don't take it, the world suffers. And if we don't take it, people will take it from us.
That's true.
And so today, man up. The message. The way God showed me to approach this is to look and see how did Jesus Christ build men. How did he do it? Now, when you think about like the dangerous, strong man who is powerful and can do whatever is necessary to take care of business in any situation, if you ask people in the world, like, what's the image of a powerful man? If you ask people, they don't say, well, I think Jesus. They don't say that. They say, well, like, you know, John Wayne, Clint Eastwood, you know, some MMA fighter of today, you know, something where, like, somebody is just bad to the bone. You know, Jesus is bad to the bone while he's being good to the bone. And so you think about that. How can the carpenter of Nazareth be the image of total masculine testosterone manhood? You see these pictures of Jesus. Do you know which one I'm talking about? The one of him in the garden? You know, he's got the light coming down like this, and he's got his hands up on the rock. And it used to be in my Sunday school classrooms as a kid. His hands up on the rock, and he's got like his long hair. It's not like cool, like rock band long hair. It's not like it's not like a Jesus mullet. Like, we didn't know it was called mullet back in the 80s. We just thought it was cool. But I'm not going to ask for a show of hands who had one. But it wasn't the cool hair. It's like Jesus has, like, in that picture, he's got pretty hair. Like, Jesus, did you go to the beauty parlor before you had this portrait made or something? And he's got that milky kind of white skin. And his eyes are all riched up, all like pretty, like this. And there's nothing like powerfully man. There's no carpenter there. There's nobody who's swinging a hammer there. There's nobody who's cutting logs in half there. That's not my Jesus. And we think about like, who has raised up more men to do more in this world than anybody else? Jesus has. In the name of Jesus, men have built hospitals. In the name of Jesus, men have built orphanages. In the name of Jesus, men have defended the weak. In the name of Jesus, people have rescued people from danger, sickness, from being killed. In the name of Jesus, people have overcome sin.
Amen.
There's no image of manhood that can rip sin out of a man's heart besides Jesus Christ.
Right.
And so today I want to walk through, how did Jesus get men to be men? And what was his method? Number one is this: need him. Need him. The message today is this. And sometimes it's because some men have failed. But the message is like this in our world. Like, well, because many men have not really done their duty, let's just decide that men aren't needed. Let's just decide that it's not important. You don't have to show up and do anything. We can do it without you. We can do the home without you. Of course we can. God's there. But God's chosen for a man to be there. We can do government without you. We can do the church without you. You are not needed, really, as a man. But what did Jesus do? Now, the word need is kind of strong here because you don't think about God needing someone. But look at the text, the selection of the 12. In verse 13 of Mark 3, and by the way, this is in all three of the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Verse 13 says, and he went up on the mountain and summoned those whom he himself, what word does he use? Wanted. He summoned those whom he wanted. You think about the image of Uncle Sam. Maybe they're reading this passage and came up with Uncle Sam. I want you. And he went up on the mountain. And so he climbed a mountain. Okay, I've been to Israel, and I've seen some of those mountains. And there's one in particular that we kind of think this probably was. You got to be some kind of a man to climb that mountain and pray on it. He said, and they came to him, and he appointed the 12 so that they would be with him and that he could send them out to preach. The selection of the 12. Now here's the problem with needing somebody, and creating the position. Here's the problem. You don't know if he's going to fill that position. And the mentality is, because we don't know if this man's going to show up and do his best, let's just kind of create the environment where he doesn't have to do anything. Let's create the environment, or at least not be vulnerable enough to say, a man is needed here. That's Satan's plan to degrade manhood in this world. And look at Jesus. He says, and he summoned those he himself wanted, and they came to him. Now, for Jesus, he knew that it did not decrease or insult his position in life and before God and in this world if someone he called did not respond. But that's why we don't need people in life. Because we've had too many times where we called on somebody and they didn't do what we thought they should do, or they didn't do what they said they were going to do. And for Jesus, it's like this. I'm not afraid. I'll call this man. And if he does show up, then great. That's great for him. But when Jesus says he needs, when this idea of wanting or needing a man, if we can take on his perspective, then we can be safe in needing him. Needing a man as a friend. Needing a man to lean on. Needing a man to depend on. Because if I'm already leaning on the Father, if I'm already leaning on the Father, then if a man doesn't hold me up, I still don't fall. If I'm already leaning on the Father, I don't have to be afraid of falling if someone else doesn't fulfill their position. So it didn't reduce Jesus. So Jesus wasn't wringing his hands thinking like, hey, if all 12 don't show up, if these people I call don't come up to the mountain, then what am I going to do? How am I going to get my work done? What's going to happen to this world? I better not need them. That's not Jesus. He's totally and completely whole, whether somebody else does something or not. That's the kind of need that God wants us to need when we need men. Verse 14, he appointed them so they could be with him and he could send them out to preach. And this is beautiful because a lot of times we want men to do things or be with us. But the true nature of manhood is this: be with me and do stuff. Because a man doesn't want to do stuff if he doesn't sense that you don't want him. And a man doesn't want to be wanted as a man if there's no purpose for him to do something. It goes together. It goes together.
Amen.
And think about Adam in the garden. God created Adam for fellowship with him. He walked with him in the cool of the day in the garden. And he also said, have dominion over the earth. Do something with your man. Luke 6 is another part of the passage. It's describing the same event. And it says, it was at this time that Jesus went off to the mountain to pray. And in Luke, he includes this. And he spent the whole night in prayer to God. If we were to follow the model of Jesus, when we want men to be men, Jesus spent some time in prayer about that. It was so important to him that he prayed all night about it. Wait a minute. God himself prayed all night long that men would show up, be accountable, and realize that they're needed? What if we did that same thing in our families, in our church, for our children, for our friends? He went up to the mountain to pray. Spent all night in prayer. Now show me who. Not just any sucker. Show me who. Not just any weirdo. But show me who, God. Ladies, follow this if you're single, okay? It's important. He spent the whole night in prayer to God. God, show me who. And then, God, it's necessary. Let's look at the next thing. Need him. And then the next one is, it's, all these are something him. Because it's building a culture in which men are honored. The man up culture. Number two is, ask him. The calling of Matthew. Matthew was a tax collector, but he was also kind of not just a tax collector like we think of a tax collector. He was on the Roman government's payroll, but the way he got paid was by collecting more taxes than the people owed. And so he was hated. So if you associate yourself with somebody who's that degraded of a man, you think to yourself, I can't be associated with him. That's going to lower me as a man. But Jesus, in all his manhood, see, he knows this, that God plus a degraded man equals man up. If you can ever see that a man who has sold himself to this world and to do wrong. See, Matthew didn't believe that God would support him. He had to go out and he wouldn't took from others. He deprived families of the money that was needed to feed their children. And Jesus never said, "Ah, that guy's too far. He's not worth it." There's so many times when a man doesn't meet our expectations, we want to say, "Oh, he's not worth it. He's not redeemable." Jesus had the opposite view. Oh, this man, he knows how bad he is. The rest of you just don't know him yet. Let me go to him. And he says, he went to the tax booth and he said to him, "Follow me." He asked him and he asked him directly. And he left everything behind and he got up and to follow him. Let me tell you what doesn't work in life. This is what doesn't work. I hope some of you will help with this. Doesn't work. I hope some of you men will show up to this. I hope some of you men will help him this way. No. What a man needs in his heart is to know he's needed in general as a man. And then he's needed specifically, not just men are needed, but you. I'm asking you. What about these other guys? No, you. I remember the first time I ever asked a man to join me in the starting of this church. We had come from seminary and we were coming in. I went visiting with a man at his house. And the first thing he asked me was, "Why are you asking me? Why are you asking me?" And I thought to myself, I hadn't thought that far. God, I gave that quick breath prayer. And some of you might not have thought that far. And I had that breath prayer. And I said, I looked in his eyes and I said, "Because you're an influencer. And I believe that you can do in God's kingdom far more than you're doing now. And God's plan is not for you to do a little. God's plan is for you to do a lot. And a lot of people are going to be blessed if you stand up and you help, and you serve, because I think you have a lot to offer." What a powerful moment. Ask him. And ask him. See, but that puts you vulnerable, doesn't it? When you ask someone, a person specifically for them, you have to have enough confidence in God. No matter what they do, God's still going to take care of what's needed. You have to trust God more than you trust the man you're asking. If you don't trust God more than you trust the man you're asking, then you can't ask him. You're too afraid to ask him. You're thinking, "Oh no, what if it doesn't work out? I better just stay over here." Especially if you've already been through it with several different friends as men or several different relationships with men. You know that people will let you down. Men have track records at times. But you know what I think sometimes is the real reason behind this? Nobody ever said, "You." We can blame people for letting us down, but when we look in their eyes and say, "I still need you to do this, will you do it?" Matthew he got up, everything. Now it says Jesus said, follow me. Let me tell you what he didn't do. He didn't manipulate Matthew. He didn't try to force Matthew. When you deal with a man, you deal with him with respect. Did Matthew deserve respect? No. He didn't say, follow me or you're going to hell, Matthew. He didn't say, follow me or it's going to be bad off for you. You're going to lose this business. He didn't say, follow me or this is your last chance. Just simple, open, personal request. If you're going to be a leader in God's church, you're going to work with volunteers. Okay? And you're also going to work with volunteers who don't follow through sometimes. If you ever stop asking directly, you'll never have any results. So God's going to follow the model of Jesus to raise those men up. Look at the next thing here. Not only need him, not only ask him, appreciate him. Appreciate him. Jesus called them friends. John 15, 15. He says, I don't call you servants anymore because a servant doesn't know what his master is doing. But I've called you friends. One of my favorite things about drawing people into God's service is to say this. People serve because they love Jesus, and people serve because they love you. The main way to walk with other people and to see God at work in their life and to see them get a handle on what God can do in their life is to extend your friendship into their lives. You can't influence people that you won't be that you're not willing to be their friend. And if you want to have a friend, you got to do what?
Be a friend.
If you're going to be a friend, it's going to cost you something. And we're not all the world's greatest friends, are we, men? I can't be everything for everybody. You can't be everything for everybody. But you sure can be something for somebody. And that's the key to everything. A man without friends, without Christian friends, is truly somebody to be pitied. And Jesus says this, I'm a friend who sticks closer than a brother. I don't call you servants anymore because a servant doesn't know what his master is doing. He said, I've made it all known to you. I'm open. I'm transparent. I've hidden nothing from you. The way to make people insiders is to give them inside information. I'm hiding nothing from you. I want you to be an insider. He appreciated them by giving them his love and his friendship. There can be no greater appreciation from God than to say, you're my friend. Like it said of Abraham, he was called a friend of God. Now, Jesus, here, I've called you friends. And see, you can be any man's friend if you're... I want to be Christ's friend first.
Amen.
Appreciate it. Next one is hold him accountable. I like this about the story of Peter. In the story of Peter, Peter needed a lot of molding. The person who is the most bold is the person that needs the most molding. They have to be broken and reshaped and broken and reshaped. But that person who acts kind of rebellious and wants to do extra stuff that you didn't ask him to do or kind of comes on kind of strong, usually that's just a sign of somebody with a lot of energy. It's got to be directed. Somebody who's strong-willed can be very powerful after they're broken by God. And so here's Peter, molding Peter. Here's three things. One, entrust him with responsibility. Let me tell you what it kind of looks like when I look at families today, is this. It used to be the family had a lot of work to do, and boys got entrusted with responsibility early. Think about David out watching the sheep. He has entrusted with those sheep. He had real responsibility when he was young. And I think many times in this culture where we try to keep everybody safe, Have you ever noticed, like, the biggest thing the parents talk about is, well, you can't let that happen because he might get hurt. We can't let this happen because he might get hurt. And I know we probably don't have many families like this here, but the number one way to make a boy never become a man, to never man up, is to never put him in a situation where he can really fail. They have to have real responsibility. The younger somebody can have, boys should have any responsibility that they are able to have as soon as they can have it. Because the earlier they handle some responsibility, the older they get, the more responsibility they will willingly accept. And sometimes I've seen this with the fathers being this way, but sometimes I've seen it with the mothers being this way. Oh, protect him. Oh, don't let him do that. Oh, just do it for him. If he can wash his own clothes, let him wash his own clothes. If he can cook himself something, let him cook himself something. Or be hungry. He can wear dirty clothes to school. I mean, they're not going to put him in detention, right? As soon as some girl says, "You smell bad," he's going to want to wash his clothes. You know? And if his room never gets cleaned up, make him stay in the room. Live in that room. You're going to do everything in that room. You spend the rest of your life in that room. It's okay with me. Entrust him with real responsibility. You can find every reason in the world why something shouldn't be done, right? Don't look for ways to not do it. Look for ways to do it. Ladies, let me tell you, the number one way to ensure that the man in your life never does something that you want him to do, the number one way to ensure that he never does something that you're asking him to do is to do it for him. Next thing is this in Peter's life. Allow consequences, but with mercy. Jails in our country are filled with people that got consequences too late in life. Allow consequences early, but with mercy. Now this is treading on tough stuff, isn't it? Because if he gets that consequence, maybe it'll break him. If he gets this consequence, he'll get hurt. Well, you got to get before God, and you got to trust God with that man or that man to be. You got to trust God with that man. See, you can entrust a man and hold him accountable if you trust God and hold God accountable. That sounds weird to hold God accountable, but you got to say these words: God, this is this man. And I say it about grown men in our church all the time to God. God, you know what he's doing? Over these 15 years, I've had to say it a lot of times. God, he's not listening to me anymore, God. I can't fix him, God. He's your son, God, more than he's my church member, God. I trust you with him, God. He's not my responsibility, God. He's yours. I've done everything I can do. I've done what I'm supposed to do. And if you do more than you're supposed to do, you will be accountable for that man's life, and he won't be accountable for his life. Allow consequences, but with mercy. Matthew 14, 30 and 31 is that story where Jesus got out of where Jesus was out walking on the water, and he calls to the men and he says, they're afraid, they think it's a ghost out there. And then he says, it's me. And they say, Lord, it's the Lord. And Peter says, oh yeah? It's a chance for me to kind of get recognized. Here comes Peter's pride again. It's funny because it's his boldness and it's his aggressiveness, but it's also his stupidity at the same time. Doesn't that sound like some men you know? He's courageous. He's amazing. He's powerful and a little stupid. All at the same time. I mean, like if it was redneck, if it was redneck and like down on Lake Sinabon, Okay, if this was not the Sea of Galilee, but Lake Seminole, if it was Lake Eufaula here, it'd be like the redneck Peter saying, y'all watch this. Y'all watch this. Y'all watch this. I'm going to get out of this boat. And Jesus, he's like, God, but Jesus says, oh yeah? Come on, bad boy. Come on, boy. You can do it. Come on. Come on. You want to come? Come. It's a good thing, you know, there wasn't anybody around to say, oh, Peter, you might get hurt. Oh, Peter, don't do it. You might get hurt, Peter. Oh, you better not try, Peter. You better not. That's just too bold, Peter. No. What Peter's mama would have said. Peter's wife would have said. See, wasn't there? He probably would have stayed in the boat. Or maybe he had one of those mamas that said this, you get out there, boy. You get out there, boy. He says, allow consequences, but with mercy. Matthew 14, 31 and 30 and 31. He began to sink. You got to let the man sink sometimes. You've got to let the man sink sometimes. Friend, son, brother, husband. Got to let the man sink sometimes. He's got to feel like there's no net sometimes. Even if there is one. He cried out, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched out took his hand and took hold of him. Consequences, okay, everybody saw you sink. But everybody also saw you get out of the boat. A man should be entrusted to get out of the boat. And a man should be entrusted to sink or swim. And a man should be entrusted to be in that place where only Jesus can save him. The third thing is, confront him when wrong. You do not love a man if you don't confront a man. The problem I see a lot of times is this. It's hard to confront some men. It's just hard. We want him to kind of figure it out, right? We want him to be like, you know, if he loves me, he won't do that. If he loves me, he won't say that. You know, I've seen couples, okay, get divorced after years and years and years. And the lady says things like this. I never even knew that he thought that. Well, did you ask him? Well, no, I thought he would tell me. But he was doing all this. Did you say anything? No, I thought if he loved me, he wouldn't. Well, if you love him, you have to confront him. Or he'll continue. Because he's not only a man made in the image of God, he's a man made in the image of Adam, too. And Adam just ignores the problem. My wife talking to a snake? I don't know. I've been talking to that snake for a while now. You know? Or, you know, Adam. He could have been confronted, right? Confront him when he's wrong. You don't confront a man when he's wrong. But ladies and other men, don't wait until you're angry to say anything. Don't wait until you're angry to say something. Say something when it's wrong. Don't wait until you're angry to say it. If you wait until you're angry to say it, don't be surprised that he doesn't listen. Because you got to speak the language of respect when you speak the language of confrontation. If you don't speak the language of respect when you speak the language of confrontation, your confrontation will never be heated unless it's a very wise man. And not every man is very wise. Right? It's tough to do it. All these things are hard. But think about the 12 disciples and think about their disciples and think about their disciples all the way to you today. Your my sins are forgiven. Our lives are moving in the direction of God. We have Bibles. Because Jesus turned and said, "Get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block to me. Your interest, you're not setting your mind on God's interest, but on man's interest." And I don't think Jesus was angry when he said this. Because he's got the authority of God. He doesn't need the authority of anger. Oh, I could say that a whole couple of times. He doesn't need the authority of anger. He got the authority of God. He said, "Peter, you're a stumbling block to me." "I'm a what?" "I'm sorry, Peter, you're a stumbling block to me. And I'm not going to stumble over you and your opinions. Peter, you're setting your mind on not on God's interest, but on your own and your friend's interest. You promised to put me first. This isn't putting me first." What a challenge. I mean, think about saying that to a man. "You promised to put this first, and you're not putting this first." That was a challenge. Men love to meet challenges. Men run from disrespect and insolence, but love to meet challenges. This is the last thing today is this. Give him credit. I've heard a lot of people say a lot of times, like, "Well, this man, all he wants is credit. All he wants is credit. Every time he does something, he wants me to say something. All he wants is credit." He wants credit all the time. He wants credit for this. He wants credit for that. He wants credit for the other thing. You're like, men walk around, most of us, I mean, it's not that healthy to walk around like this with a scoreboard in our brains. And we're trying to put numbers on the board. We're trying to put numbers on the board. And we count you as a teammate if you'll recognize the numbers on the board. I'm trying to put numbers up on the board. I got a three-pointer waiting. It's just, bam, it's right there. Woo! 3 points. I ran it all the way to the end zone. Our team is winning. Men love to be on a winning team. Love to be on a winning team. And in this position here, Jesus even went outside the 12 to give his biggest statement to another man of credit. A centurion, a leader of 10, a leader of, I'm sorry, 100 Roman soldiers came to Jesus. And the centurion said, "Lord, I'm not worthy for you to come under my roof, but just say the word. Jesus, I respect you and your power so much. If you're willing to give the order that my servant be healed, then I accept that as an order that you have changed in the universe. So Lord, you just give the order and I believe it. And I'll be on my way. I don't want to take up any of your important time, Jesus. I'm not here to whine. I'm not here to complain. I'm not here to bend your ear. I'm here not here to take up your time. I'm not here to ruin your day. I'm here to ask you to exercise your authority. So would you come, Jesus, and just speak to me and just say it. It'll be done. Just say the word and my servant will be healed." Look at verse 10. Jesus' response to the crowd. Now check this out. It was in the presence of the 12 disciples and everybody else that he noticed and gave tremendous credit to this man's faith. Now, when Jesus heard this, he marveled and said to those who were following, "Truly I say to you, none of the rest of you have this kind of faith," is what he said.
Amen.
he totally looked this guy up. He totally gave credit. He's not Jewish. He's not a follower, really, of Jesus? Yet? But don't you believe after he got this credit, he was wanting to come to the source?
Amen.
Amen. After he gave credit, he was coming back? If you take numbers off the board in a man's life, he wants to join the other team. And I'll never get ahead on this team. I'm never going to... No matter what I do, I can't win. Jesus was saying to the centurion, I'll let you win. You're winning in faith. You're winning in faith. We're putting numbers up on the board for you, buddy. You're a superstar of faith. Giving this man credit. Did it verbally, did it openly, did it publicly, and I believe he came back for more. He came back for more. Now, if you don't like to give a man credit, you think, oh, I can't do that because, like, my friend, he'll just relax if I do this with a friend of mine. He's going to get the big head if I do this with a friend of mine. If I do that, what I'm saying is that I have a different and better way to raise men up than Jesus. Jesus was willing to say, I want you and need you. Jesus was willing to say, well, to ask somebody specifically, I'd like for you to please do this. Will you? Jesus is willing to appreciate somebody and say, hey, you're my friend. I put my heart to you, my friend. He was willing to hold people accountable, even if he had to oppose and confront his friend. And Jesus gave credit for credit was due. And I believe in this church family that God wants to unleash more men to be men of God in a powerful way.